I'd like to begin by asking you all a question. How much do you know about the ocean? Now, whether you're thinking, not much, or I'm an expert because I'm an oceanographer, the reality is that we've only explored about 5% of the ocean. But what we do know is that the ocean covers almost 3/4 of the Earth's surface and is responsible for processes such as thermal regulation and producing oxygen. So ocean monitoring is important to track changes in temperature, acidity, and concentrations of nutrients to detect and prevent situations such as coral bleaching and algal blooms. It's also important for the sake of exploration and discovery, like finding new creatures such as this adorable sea bunny nudibranch. Now, there are a few different methods of ocean monitoring. One is using remotely operated vehicles, ROVs, which are basically like small cars that are attached to boats via these long cables. Another is autonomous underwater vehicles, AUVs, like this glider, for example. And these are great tools for making ocean measurements because they can reach areas of the ocean that boats and divers can't, but there are a few challenges. These can be very costly, they can also be very bulky, and they can leave more unnatural vehicle wakes that might disturb more sensitive areas of the ocean. So this is where bio-inspired robots come in. By creating these robots that mimic how animals naturally move, we can create more energy-efficient aquatic vehicles that can leave more natural wakes to minimize disturbances to the environment. As a few examples here, we have the robotic fish, manta ray, and jellyfish. And these can be used to collect images, data such as temperature measurements, and take samples of water from new locations. But the question remains, which animal model do we choose? Now, the title of my talk already gives it away, but I'm going to be talking about jellyfish. So Aurelia aurita, or moon jellyfish, are a simple energy-efficient model organism for two reasons. The first reason is that about 1/4 of the total distance traveled occurs when the jellyfish is passive and relaxed, so no extra energy is expended in order to travel forward. The second is that jellyfish have a low cost of transport, which is a metric of energy efficiency. And you can kind of think of it as the opposite of miles per gallon, so something like gallons per mile. And the important thing to note is that a low cost of transport equates to a high energy efficiency. So as you can see on this graph, which plots cost of transport for different modes of transportation, for animals of the same mass, you can see that running has the highest cost of transport, which means that it's the least energy efficient, followed by flying, followed by different forms of swimming, with jellyfish all the way there at the bottom. So jellyfish are one of the most energy efficient animals. But you can imagine that there's this spectrum of bio-inspired jellyfish constructs. And on one end of the spectrum, we have a purely robotic jellyfish, like Robo Jelly here, which is great because we can control all of the design parameters and the inputs and outputs. But the main limitation here is high power consumption. So a lot of these robots are still tethered to some external power source. On the opposite end of the spectrum, we have more of a biological construct, like this artificial jellyfish created by seeding rat cardiac cells onto a silicon scaffold. And this is beautiful bioengineering work, but the limitation here is that these constructs are difficult enough to keep alive in the lab, so we can't exactly send these out into the ocean at the moment. The solution that I've been working on is to create a biohybrid robot by using the animal itself as a natural scaffold and embedding microelectronics in to control how it moves. And this is a low power and a low cost solution. And this is also adaptable to a variety of environments because that's where these animals are naturally found. So now let's take a step back to discuss how jellyfish naturally swim. So this is a jellyfish bell oriented upside down. The bottom layer is called the subumbrellar surface and the top layer is called the exumbrella. This image shows a jellyfish in a dish, subumbrellar surface up. And you can see along the edge of the bell within each of these 8 little divots is a swim pacemaker, or a sensory organ that innervates the swim muscle, which is the single layer of muscle oriented in a ring on the subumbrellar surface. In order to swim, jellyfish activate these pacemakers, which then activates the muscle and causes that to contract. This is called the power stroke. There's also the recovery stroke in which the muscle relaxes. And the interesting thing to note is that this is essentially an all or nothing muscle activation. So even if only one of these pacemakers fires, that causes the entire muscle ring to activate eventually, starting from that one location. But we're not constrained by the biology. We can use electrodes to act as artificial pacemakers to activate the muscles. So I've been working on this portable swim controller that embeds into the jellyfish at the center with an electrode that embeds directly into the swim muscle. And I know you guys are all wondering, does this harm the jellyfish? And the answer is that it doesn't seem to harm the jellyfish in the long term. In fact, jellyfish don't have a brain or a central nervous system, and immediately after the swim controller is removed, the jellyfish swims and feeds as usual. So let's take a closer look. Within this 3D printed acrylic housing, we have a series of microelectronics. Right now, it's just the battery and the chip that controls the electrode, but in the future, we can incorporate things such as temperature sensors. The electrode is an LED that flashes every time a signal gets sent through the electrode, and the device embeds into the center of the jellyfish via this toothpick, which is actually holds onto the tissue much better than other engineered materials because of the microscopic barbs in the wood. The beauty of biology, right? So, this is an example of what my cyborg jellyfish looks like, with the swim controller operating at a frequency of half a hertz, meaning that there's one signal every 2 seconds. You can see here, with this one electrode embedded at the side of the jellyfish, every time the LED flashes red, that's when a signal is occurring at that muscle location, and you can see this clear muscle wave propagating from that point. From experiments like this, but using two electrodes, I can characterize how different frequencies of the swim controller control the swimming speed. So the main takeaways I want you to remember from today are that we don't know much about the ocean, but we can control jellyfish swimming in a laboratory environment. Now, there are a lot of challenges translating this work from the lab into the ocean, but I hope that I've convinced you that this is a promising direction for ocean monitoring. And with that, I'd like to thank the members of the Dabiri Lab, Cabrillo Marine Aquarium, and my funding sources. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact me here, or you can find me later today. Thank you very much.